We're ready to start our next session with 40% of our panelists, because the remaining 60% are on their way. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Kanishk Tharoor and Devdan Chaudhuri. To start the session on how did Donald trump the press and poll pundits, Deepa Iyer, Sandip Roy, and Firoozeh Dumas will join us very shortly.
So, welcome to the session. And as you just heard, our other panelists are on the way. So, Kanishk and myself will just start talking and try to understand how did Donald Trump win the US elections? And Kanishk, just start off with your initial comments of the environment that was there in the US for the entire political months. And ultimately, we'll start talking about the factors behind it.
Well, okay. First of all, I want to say it's such a pleasure to be here in Calcutta. This is a city that's really, I live in New York City, but and I grew up there most of my life. But this is a city that, apart from New York, is really my home. And it's a pleasure to be speaking to a Calcutta audience as well. My wife and I are just in Calcutta for a few weeks, and we timed our visit to miss the inauguration of Donald Trump, in part because we couldn't really face the reality of it. And I know that when the country that we left is already not going to be the country that we return to when we go back in a few weeks. You know, Devdan, you asked me about the climate that was in the U.S. at the time of the election, and you know, as you all know, I think you all are quite familiar with the astonishment with which both his initial rise, his securing of the Republican nomination, and then obviously his subsequent victory was met by the media and by the sort of circles of authority making and consensus forming in the media and elsewhere in society. I think the entire world was gripped with a kind of disbelief, and I think that became almost a kind of cliche, the expressing of disbelief at Trump. So I don't want to really return to that, but I just want to note a few things that have just happened in the last few days that we should think about, you know, before the other panelists come, in terms of what is happening in the United States right now, directly as a result of Trump's election. First of all, as you know, he inherits a political system where he has unprecedented power in recent years. He has both houses of Congress. He has a vacant seat in the Supreme Court in which he can appoint a new justice. He has over 100 appointments to make in the federal system, the federal judicial system, because those appointments under Obama were blocked and stymied by the Republicans. So once he does all these things, he's going to have even greater control over the political process in the United States than any president in recent history. Despite all that, he has, in the last few days, his first few days of being in power, issued an astonishing number of executive orders that, bypassing constitutional procedures, are enacting new sorts of systems and laws in the United States. Today, as many of you may have seen, he's issued an executive order stopping the intake of any refugees to the United States and banning the giving of visas to citizens from 6 different countries, predominantly Muslim countries, but that list may expand. He's issued an executive order to commence the building of this much vaunted wall on the border between the United States and Mexico. And then when you couple this with many of the appointments he's made across the cabinet, it's a very worrying state of affairs. The kinds of people he's appointed to, say, for example, his potential Secretary of Education is going to be somebody who doesn't believe in public education and is actively invested in companies that encourage the dismantling of public schools. You can go down the list of the conflicts of interest of his cabinet members, from his Secretary of Commerce to his Secretary of defense to his new secretary for energy, who doesn't even understand the job he has to do. Rick Perry, when he was told that he was going to be secretary of energy, had no idea that he had to be in charge of the nuclear system in the United States as well. Anyway, but sorry, I just wanted to.
I just want to make a comment on what you said. These are very valid comments, but it is slightly more complex than that. And Trump also basically withdrew basically U.S. from TPP. You know, that was a highly contentious trade issue where many Democrats were against TPP also, like Sanders and Elizabeth Warren. He has also done that. So at one point of time, when Sanders lost out and Trump came and said, this is our movement, and also borrowed certain narratives which was Sanders was speaking. So he was actually being smart as to hold his Republican vote base by making those outlandish comments and, you know, xenophobic, anti-immigration, you know, religious and misogynist. But he had also moved towards the voters of Sanders and said that this is a movement and I also believe TPP should go and this and that, you vote for me. And that ultimately worked in certain way because there were some three states which was absolutely Democratic who had voted for Obama for 8 years, like Michigan, Pennsylvania and all, they flipped over. So basically they flipped over to Trump. So this was a really unexpected phenomena because I don't think the Clinton clan thought that those states will flip over. So why did this flipping over happen? You know, you can see.
That's a fair point. I mean, you know, this entire election, as you know, rested on the fate of three states, Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania. These are states that are kept in what's known as the Rust Belt, states that once were defined by a huge amount of industry, which has now in large part gone into great decline and shed a lot of jobs. And his winning of those three states is what tilted the election, and he won them by about 77,000 votes. So one response to this after the election was to suggest that, oh, this is proof that Hillary Clinton ignored the needs and concerns of the white working class, and therefore somehow made some complete miscalculation about the nature of the American polity. And I think there's something to her naivety. For example, she never, and this was something bandied about quite a bit after the election, she never once during the general election campaigned in the state of Wisconsin because she assumed that it was in the bag for her. Now that I mean, and I think tactically there was much to fault in her operation. I'm not entirely convinced that these sort of Bernie Sanders-esque concerns are the reason Trump won those states.
Being one of the factors which contributed to his, you know, and like whatever, because his popularity and the Democratic vote base actually fell down, you know, throughout you know, United States of America, contrasting to the number of votes Obama had won. So Democratic base has shrunk. So why did this
actually
thing happen?
That's an earlier stat. That stat was she actually won more votes than almost any other candidate in history.
That is popular vote she won, but I'm talking about in certain areas. If you look at area wise, that votes have fallen. So this is what has happened, and this happened beyond three states also. Like states where she won, also there was certain decline in the Democratic vote.
No, yeah. I don't doubt that, and I think, you know, I personally never felt that Hillary Clinton was a terribly convincing candidate. I think you and I might share many criticisms of her, which we might be able to get into at some point. But, you know, I think those 77,000 votes, there's been a lot of attention given to them in a way that I think distorts the larger forces happening in the United States. And some of the wider context to this election that doesn't necessarily just have to do with people in Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, and Michigan. So I don't want to linger too much on what.
Yeah, what are the other factors?
Yeah. Well, maybe we can allow our new panelists onto the stage.
Yeah, welcome. Firoozeh, Deepa, and Sandip, please join us. We just started and we started to talk a bit without you all. Yeah, please.
One thing I will say, which I think, you know, to give it slightly wider context, is the economist Branko Milanovic published a graph that was sort of very widely disseminated over the past year, which I think is worth considering when we talk about issues like globalization and free trade and so forth, which shows that in the last, I think since the late 70s, the only percentiles of people who have seen experienced stagnation in their wage growth occupy about the 70th to the 90th percentile. Everybody else, the very top and the bulk of other people in the world, have seen significant growth in their income. And that's a demonstration of the extent to which in the world we live in, it's the working and middle classes in the West that are really suffering, supposedly, because of globalization. And that is a phenomenon that sort of ties the results in Brexit to what you saw in Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania, which, as Devdan was intimating, might be one of the reasons. But that and that's one of the forces behind Trump. But I definitely don't think it's the only one.
So we'll try to figure out what are the forces and what are the factors. And just to welcome the panelists. And we are just discussing, initially beginning with your initial comments about why do you think Trump won? And what are the factors do you think which went in his favor? Because ultimately he won. So can we start with Firoozeh?
Yeah. Hi. First of all, apologies for being late. There was traffic in Kolkata. Well, first of all, I know none of you have ever heard of me, but I am an Iranian-American writer. And for the past 13 years, I've actually been on the lecture circuit, mainly talking about my first book, Funny in Farsi, which is the story of our immigrating to America from Iran. And it's a story, I'm a humorist, so it's a book that is funny, but it's about shared humanity. And the reason I've been on the lecture circuit is because I want Americans to have a view of what a Middle Eastern family is like. Because in America, the only time you see a Middle Easterner on the news, if it's A, somebody with a beard who's very angry, or a terrorist. And I very much wanted to give an alternate view. So I do, I go to schools all over the country, all over the United States to speak. And I have spent a lot of time in rural America, in places where literally I'm the only Middle Easterner where these people have spoken with. I'm sort of the Iranian to go. And one of the things I've discovered in going to these towns, often in the Rust Belt, is that people, so many Americans have truly no concept of the Middle East. They have no concept of the history. They have no concept of US foreign policy in the Middle East. Absolutely none of that. And you know, when I first came to America, people were constantly asking me about camels, which was a letdown for them when they found out we had a Chevrolet. But so what happened, I think, with Trump is he came in and played on people's worst fears about the Middle East. I think that was a big part of his campaign. And because he had a group of people who really were not able to think critically whatsoever about what he was saying, they bought it. And I think there's so many people who blame things on the Middle East that have absolutely nothing to do with the Middle East. And when you talk about, you look at statistics of, you know, terrorism in the US, you know, you're much more likely to be killed, you know, by a gun owned by, you know, a white American than by terrorists. But these things, you know, logic doesn't really exist. And the other thing is, I remember when the Iranian Revolution happened, there was a rumor going around beforehand where people were saying that if you looked up at the moon, you could see Khomeini's face. And, you know, I was about 13 at the time, and I thought, what are you people crazy? But millions of people believe this. And one thing I learned is how easily people can be duped. And I feel like, you know, Trump has done a masterful job of truly duping people about fears that they already had a little bit of, but now he's really stoked the fire. So I think that the lack of critical thinking really worked
in his favor. So you are saying that like a perception of the Muslim identity and also the anti-immigration sentiment was a major factor.
Absolutely.
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 Like Deepa, your initial comments, then I'll come to other topics.
Sure. Also wanted to just thank all of you for being here. It's a pleasure to be here. This is my first time in Kolkata. So just very quickly, I was born and raised in Trivandrum, Kerala, and moved to the United States, to the state of Kentucky, when I was 12. And my background in the United States is that I'm a lawyer and an activist. I work primarily on civil rights and immigrant rights issues, and I wrote a book recently on the 15 years after the 9/11 attacks and how South Asian communities, Muslim Arab communities, have been affected and responded to that. So in terms of your question, I think a lot of folks have already spoken to some of the factors that Donald Trump won the presidency. I think a few others I would say really quickly are, and I think there was a lot of misogyny towards Secretary Clinton that led to this. I also think that Trump played on fears related to the loss of sort of the true America. The real America. And that's something that we have seen, you know, since 9/11. The factors of anti-immigrant sentiment, you know, these people are coming over, they're taking over our jobs, and there are no jobs left. Everything is either being outsourced or it's done by an immigrant. Those sorts of fears have been stoked in the U.S. over the past 15 years. Islamophobia, another phenomenon that, well, we have to be scared. We live in a culture of fear. And so national security and the otherizing of Muslims and anyone perceived to be Muslim as security threats is another phenomenon. And then the third phenomenon is really around what I call racial anxiety in the United States. And this comes from the fact that, as you likely know, America is on its way to becoming a, quote, majority-minority nation. So by 2040, minorities will be the majority of the country, people of color, communities of color. And Latinos and Asians are kind of driving the demographic changes in the racial landscape in America. So that has also fed into a lot of anxiety. We're losing, some people say, and Donald Trump played to this, losing the true America. We need to bring it back. Make America great again, right, is really kind of a slogan that oftentimes means make America white again. And so those are some of the factors that he played into. And he really used a lot of code switching, didn't necessarily say these words, but he was playing to these fears of the other, the national security threat, the immigrant who takes over jobs, and the changes in the customs and culture of what America is. And we can see that in his policies this week, this is his first week as president, a lot of this is playing out. It wasn't just rhetoric or language, it is now also policy.
Sandip, your comments.
Hi, and apologies again. We had a very long roundabout way to get here. I want to just sort of echo what Deepa has said, because I didn't hear what you had said, Kanishk, initially. But I've been writing, you know, I lived in the US for a while, and I've been writing about this election for the Economic Times and places like that. And I think you're right, Deepa, you know, make America great again was his slogan, which many regarded as code for make America white again, or make America the America we dreamed about in the 50s again. But while make America great again sounds like a sort of optimistic slogan, I saw this election as an election after a long time about fear in two ways. So Donald Trump was selling fear of the Mexican who was coming across the border who might be a rapist or a murderer. He was selling fear of the Islamic terrorist who is going to blow you up, including a gay nightclub in Florida. He was selling fear of the person who is stealing your jobs. He was selling fear of the multilateral trade deal. So it wasn't, if you saw the Republican National Convention, it was like a doomsday convention. So he was selling fear. And on the other side, Hillary Clinton ended up in a campaign where she was selling the fear of Trump. So she was selling, so for many people, it's like, oh my God, this is the only way to stop Trump. So it became an election about whose fear was bigger than the other and would triumph at the polling booth. And it turned out in the end, Donald Trump went through. And, you know, when you're talking about the code switch, I do think that the Republican Party for a long time in the US has done this sort of what we call dog whistle, which we are very used to in India, where you might be seeking votes in the name of Hindutva, but you don't need to say Hindutva. You can use code words that people understand all the time. You know, you can say the Uniform Civil Code or whatever, all kinds of various codes. People understand that. In America, that had been happening for a long time, but what Donald Trump ended up doing was he sort of put the dog whistle down and he kind of mainstreamed the xenophobia and sexism. You know, it was happening right there at his rally, and he was not even making an attempt to tamp it down, but he sort of egged it on, which was a sharp contrast to when a Trump supporter showed up at an Obama rally and started, and the Obama people at the rally started booing him. Obama kind of said, no, he looks like a veteran. He has every right to be here. You know, he has every right to be here. So it was a very different, people were just not used to that kind of blatantly laying out the xenophobia and racism. And finally, I would say one of the things that when you come to why Trump won, is people also dealt with him and reacted to him in a very traditional way, which is to contrast him with facts by saying, like, no, that is obviously wrong. In fact, that is not true. But I read this reported press thing, which really made me think, where it said, you know, Trump is not actually interested in the facts. He's not referencing, so to fact check Trump is actually a futile exercise, because what he is, he's not referencing your reality. He is trying to substitute his reality for the reality that's out there. And they quoted a Bush advisor who had told the media famously that, you know, you guys, you know, we act. So we make history, so we make the reality. And you guys do what you always do, which is very studiously study that reality. And by the time you finish studying that reality, we'll make our own reality over again. And Trump has, in fact, exactly succeeded in doing that.
And he's been doing that for years, right? He built a 58-story building, told the media it was 68 stories tall. He had this reality TV show that he always claimed to everybody was the most number one rated show in the country. It was rated number 67. This is something that he's had a long practice of doing.
So is it like that, you know, lying and lying and lying again and again,
facts,
and make it a fact in the, you know, which no longer that. And one point which I have to come back to, like in one of these point, you know, he was making a lot of, you know, vague statement, you know, that was, you know, like he actually meant something else, but he said something else. In one of the statement, I think he went on being sexist and misogynist, and he went on to suggest that the president's job is a man's job. It is not a woman's job. So why do you think, still, do you think in America, people, a lot of this, like 53% of the college-going white American voted for Trump? Why did they vote, you know? Do they really think that presidency is a man's job, it is not a woman's job? What are the factors behind this?
Try to answer that. Well, I mean, I think we have to keep in mind that the majority of white women actually voted for Donald Trump, right? And there's been a lot of questions about why have white women, many of whom are educated, why have they done that? And I think that what we hear from folks is a lot of what I think all of us laid out already around being kind of responsive to some of the fear factors, the economic growth issues. And, you know, I actually have heard from many white women that they just didn't like Hillary Clinton, right? So it wasn't necessarily that they think that a woman cannot aspire to the presidency or be president. There are glass ceilings in the United States, but women continue to crack those glass ceilings. Many women of color do it too. And so so I don't think it's that. I think there was just a visceral, either you didn't like her at all or you were just neutral about her. And I agree with Sandip. I really like the way you framed the which fear at what's going to win. And she didn't run a particularly interesting campaign. I mean, there was nothing aspirational about her campaign that you could hold on to. It was the sort of, okay, I really, really don't want him, so I'm going to vote for her. And I think a lot of people turned away from that. I will also say that another factor I think to keep in mind is that this election in many ways was a referendum on Barack Obama. In the sense that, you know, as a first black president of the United States, he endured a lot of hostility, a lot of virulent attacks, everything from questioning where he was born to whether he was Muslim, to really not giving him any sort of leeway when it comes to the way that Congress reacted to him or much of the media. And so for some time now, there has been this growth of sentiment, right, where you see a white nationalist, white supremacist movement in the United States that was building, and it was building because of the election of a black president. It was building because of what people perceived is an immigration influx It was building because of these national security fears. And what Donald Trump did in many ways is that he mainstreamed that movement. So now, you know, you have a lot of white supremacist groups who are very open and they're ready to march through towns. They're putting flyers out in different parts of this country talking about being who they are, right? Calling themselves patriots. There are even people associated with the administration who actually are known people who profess white supremacist beliefs or Islamophobic beliefs. So I think that we also have to look at this growth, this movement over the last 15 years of these really, these really hostile white supremacist movements. And my fear, and I think a lot of people are worried about this in the U.S., who are people of color, who are immigrants, is what rights are we going to have left, right? How do we resist? How do we build a resistance movement in the United States that will resist some of the policies and the rhetoric that are going to come down the pike? Because this man is, I used to laugh, but it's no laughing matter anymore, right? It's really actually going to affect the lives of women, of poor people, of immigrants, of people of color. And so so a lot of the conversation among activists in the United States is about building a resistance movement.
Yeah, Firoozeh, I just want to just extend on what she said and also add, the language of rhetoric, This is, this election has a sea change, more Trump was saying outlandish thing, his supporters were more liking it because he was actually selling it. I am not like the politicians, I don't say empty words, I'm saying what is in my heart. So he was taking that as a positive, like we all shuddered. So tell about this language of rhetoric, what happened.
One thing that was so wonderful about having President Obama was that he's such a lovely speaker. I always enjoyed listening to whatever he had to say. He's so eloquent. And I cannot listen to Donald Trump. I mean, the only two adjectives he has are great and amazing. But sad, all in capitals. But what we have to understand is that there has been in America a real anti-intellectual movement. And the fact that Obama was labeled an elitist because he's an educated man who speaks well. And I have to keep reminding myself that not everybody values the same things I do. And people appreciate that Donald Trump never says a sentence that is more than 7 words. Because he's just like them. And, as shocking as I find that, this seems to be a plus for him.
That is the, what do you think that, his tweets and all that became so popular and the language he was using was unlike anybody was using earlier. So what is about this, language of rhetoric which you...
I actually want to give him some credit because I think he's made the recognition that at a certain level, the point of language isn't meaning, right? The point of language isn't actually to make sense at a political level. His what he says on a stage or in his tweets doesn't often make sense, doesn't often have anything to do with the truth, but he managed to build an impression, often sustained by the repetition of these stupid words, right, of who he was. And that was something that, none of us find appealing, but there is, for various reasons, a stratum of society that did gravitate to that did find it appealing. And that's something we have to recognize. And what is sort of concerning now is that in the wake of his election, he seems to not, he seems to be convinced that it's going to help him to keep on in this campaigning mode of dividing people and appealing only to his sort of niche. I mean, I think, he comes from the TV world, so to call it niche is probably the accurate term, his sense of his niche audience. And in the way he's been treating the media, in the way he's been closing down the White House press corps, it bodes ill. And it seems to suggest that he's going to rule in a fairly divisive way, relying upon the support and strength of a certain segment of the country.
Sandip, some comments on this?
On the language? No, I agree with Kanishk. I think what Trump tapped into the fact that also was, people keep saying it's sort of a movement against an overdose of political correctness. But that's to dismiss not wanting to lynch someone and to say, you know, that's, it's not a matter of political correctness. You know, there's some things are just right and some things are just wrong. And to label something as politically correct just because you would rather go and lynch someone, you know, there's no justification for that. But what Trump did tap into was he realized that the more outlandish and outrageous things he said, the more people in media shuddered and that there was this whole reaction. What people failed to realize was, in fact, his supporters liked him for it. Not necessarily because they were all equally misogynist or xenophobic or racist or all of that, but because they thought, like, oh, he's really making those liberals squirm. He's really getting under their skin and getting them mad. And I think they're really smug and they deserve to squirm. So I like him for doing that. And, you know, much as I would shudder at the thought, like, you know, I read something that Kellyanne Conway, his chief counselor who managed his campaign, said, and much as I would shudder that I'm actually quoting Kellyanne Conway, is she said something which is worth remembering. She said, people vote on issues that affect them, not just on things that offend them. And we spent a lot of time being terribly offended by Donald Trump and sort of missing how he was also somehow poking certain buttons for people on issues that affected them. So that in the end, you know, when you ask the women who voted, you suddenly realize that women are not just voting because Hillary Clinton is a woman, and, you know, as a woman, I'm aghast at the kinds of things Trump says, that people are much more complex and they vote on, you know, many things. I know gay people who voted for Donald Trump because he had Peter Thiel from the Silicon Valley, who's an out gay venture capitalist who was supporting him. And they said, oh, Trump is not like those other Republicans, you know, he's actually gay friendly. In the end, it won't matter. It doesn't matter if Trump is gay-friendly or if... And Trump, very cleverly in his language, almost made himself above the rhetoric of the Republican Party platform as well. So he was just kind of like, you know, I have this bias, I have that bias, but, you know, I have gay friends, it's fine. But it doesn't mean he's going to appoint a Supreme Court justice who will not overturn gay rights. You know, he doesn't... The thing is, he's not... He may not be homophobic, but that doesn't mean he won't throw them under the bus if he needs to.
Yeah, one of the things we will come to the, you know, the like session title about media, the role of the media and the political pundits and how did they totally go wrong. And just to make some brief comments before I take this issue, like we have to realize nowadays what do we mean by the media and the press? The meaning is not the same anymore. There are a lot of people who don't watch the media, but they follow certain groups in what you call in internet, and which are extremely right-wing and things like that, and they take their news from that source. So nowadays, media means you have the right-wing, the conservative press and media channels, then you have the liberal mainstream, and you have the alternate media, who are the progressives. So the media is actually basically a spectrum of these three worldviews, and mainstream media got totally wrong. So why do you think the mainstream media could not predict at all? While, I must say, while New York Times was giving a prediction of 86% for Clinton, at the same time, an alternate media site in America called Zero Hedge was giving 86% for Trump. So why did this, you know, why did the mainstream media fail to get to the pulse of things?
So a couple of thoughts on that. I think, first of all, for the most part, the mainstream media failed to read much of the American public that ended up voting for Donald Trump, where a lot of people call that group the silent majority, that they weren't actually openly talking about their support for Trump. So they may not have polled, right? When there are pollsters from the media calling to ask you which way you lean, they may not have said it. Because there were people who wanted to vote for him, but who knew that if they made that an open, visible statement, that they might get attacked. Because of this, I don't know who said it, like the fear of offense, right? That he is an offensive person. And so they didn't want to be seen as a racist or a xenophobe or a misogynist. And so they didn't talk about it publicly. And I think it failed to show up in, I mean, even Nate Silver, who has, you know, who runs that, what is that platform that he has? Thanks. 538. Yeah. So, I mean, even he didn't, right? And he's had a very good record of predicting. So a lot of people just didn't have their true feelings out there. And I personally experienced this myself. I do. I was doing poll monitoring on election day in a very liberal town in Maryland where I live. And I was doing it primarily with Asian Americans. And for the most part, Asian Americans in the U.S., they vote Democrat. And when we were polling them, I found, and my colleagues found time and again, that many of these Asian Americans voted for Donald Trump. They actually voted Democrat on other parts of the ticket, but for president, they voted for Trump. And they were very embarrassed to actually tell us or to write that down. And they, you know, wanted to talk about it very quietly. And I realized then at that moment, you know, it was like 3 p.m. on that day, that election day, that things might not actually work out the way that most of us thought they would work out because of this silent majority that did not express its views. And then mainstream media, for that reason, kind of failed to read where the public was, at least when it depended on polls, and how the polls were not going to be a good reflection or an accurate reflection of where much of the American electorate stood.
Firoozeh, some comments on this?
No, I just want to say that when it comes to polls, the group that responds to them the most is older white women. And most polls are done by telephone, and there was a whole group that was really not being heard, and so the pollsters were actually trying to extrapolate, and they really got that wrong. I mean, that was, again, what she was saying, the silent majority.
Sandip, on this.
Well, you know, in India, we're always concerned about the entire uselessness of polls. You know, it has happened over and over again in this state itself, as well as nationally, where people say, you know, the final margins are completely different. So it's in a way, it's a, you know, it's a little relieving to know that even in America, people have not got polls down to a science that the people can still trump the polls every now and then. So there's because sometimes in America you feel like long before the first ballot is cast, everything has already been decided. It's like been polled to an inch of its life. But in this case, you are right. There are a lot of people who did not get polled. There were reports that came out afterwards, because hindsight's 2020, that in fact on Reddit groups, people who were Trump supporters encouraged people to mislead pollsters or not respond to pollsters. Because so, you know, you don't know, this is all anecdotal. You don't know how much all of it added up to. But I mean, many of you may have read this journalist named Asra Numani, who is well-known Muslim activist, writer, worked for Wall Street Journal, was a good friend of Daniel Pearl's. After Trump's election, she sort of did a coming out piece in, what's the Washington Post? Washington Post, where she came out of the closet as a Trump voter, despite the fact that most of her, you know, the rest of her politics might be very liberal. And so, you know, many people like that may have, in fact, gone for it. But having said all that, this is not to excuse the mainstream media at all. Obviously, they failed in their job. But it's not just that because the media is liberal. You have to remember Donald Trump won the presidency without the endorsement of almost any newspaper in the country, including ones that had not only endorsed Republicans in the last 100 years. Even they either endorsed Clinton or refused to endorse anyone at all. So it wasn't just the pollsters, even the sort of the big people in his party had not read, because he won in spite of his party.
Kanishk, I'll just add something so you respond. Along with this, I just want to ask, and this is the problem I want you to deliberate on, is the mainstream liberal media is failing to reach out to the other voices and perspectives which exist in the countries, which is happening all over the world, either working class or the other people who feel, you know, their voices are not being heard. Is it that mainstream media is failing into a sort of an echo chamber?
I don't know if I agree with the term mainstream liberal media. I'm not sure if that actually exists as an object. I also would say, you know, concurrent with this with this failure of the media in prognosticating, we're also seeing a decline in the newspaper, right? The newspapers are no longer, for various reasons, financial, because of the spread of information of social media. They're no longer locuses of authority that they used to be. They don't dictate what people see, what people read, what people think anymore. The one other point I wanted to just add on to this, which we haven't discussed, is that never in U.S. history since, I think, the 18th century has the country been so polarized politically in terms of geography? And this is a big change. Even, you know, in the 70s and 80s, you had a lot of, you had a lot of urban areas also going Republican, and across the country you had a fair amount of Republicans and Democrats. Now you have a real concentration of Republicans and Democrats in separate places. And that, I think, is part of the problem. Part of the problem is that, you know, a lot of people, both in the heartland, and this is not just a problem of the liberal media, so to speak, it's also a problem of people who live in the quote-unquote heartland, they are not exposed to other people. I mean, I think it's telling that, I may not know many Trump voters, but it is telling, given what we've heard just now, that the average Trump voter lived in parts of the country that were the least diverse parts of the country, that were least affected by immigration, and yet were responding to fears about immigration. So there is this sense, you know, that we have in across the board, I think, various kinds of others in play and various kinds of otherings happening.
So I'll also, like, this election was also a time where not only what was happening in US was of a concern, but what was happening outside also became a big issue. So I just want the panelists to comment upon the outside influences or the outside factors, such as WikiLeaks, Julian Assange, leaking those against Clinton Foundation, making this absolutely their cause to defeat Clinton. Then there was a Russian angle involvement, which was not yet decisively proven. So how much of these outside forces do you think, all these things which were happening outside the US borders, were a factor to decide or sway, or they were not a factor?
You know, to be honest with you, I am not sure that any of those kinds of leaks or those stories made much of an impact on swaying people who had already decided that they would vote for Donald Trump. I'm not sure that, you know, even as we've heard about this kind of Russian influence, right, and some of those stories, there just hasn't been the same amount of outrage that you would expect from people in the United States. And so I don't know that, I agree totally with what you said about, you know, this anti-intellectual, trend taking place. I mean, there's this dumbing down of America, I feel, where people are not in a culture of inquiry or asking questions or probing, and they just want to accept the reality and the facts that they believe. And so speaking in or hearing about anything that is opposite that doesn't necessarily lead many people to then say, well, wait a minute, what am I hearing? Let me question it. That process isn't happening. So I'm not really sure that those factors really had much to do with the election. I do think that this pinpointing of the Clinton Foundation or Clinton's emails, right, that just kept coming up over and over again, did do a lot to affect people who were voting for Trump. They kept bringing that up as an issue. In fact, it became more of an issue than, say, the misogyny or any of the other kinds of things that we learned about Donald Trump. It wasn't as important. So there was a lot of misogyny. I know I keep going back to that, but there has been a lot of misogyny in the country, especially around the election. But I don't think that these external factors had much to do with swaying it. I don't know if...
I think fake news also played a big role. And, you know, there was a story about ballots being found in, I think, Ohio that were already voting for Hillary Clinton. And the whole thing was fake. But, you know, God knows how many people read that. It really went viral. But one thing I want to share about fake news, because I am on the lecture circuit, people, I've always said, you know, ask me anything you want. You know, I come to your town because I would rather you ask me than not know. So I get a lot of, you know, things on Facebook and people asking me, a lot of Trump supporters asking me questions. And somebody, a Trump supporter recently said, well, how do you explain the huge rise in crime in Germany now because of the refugees? And I said, okay, I live in Germany. There has not been a huge, you know, raise in the increase in crime. So he sent me an article that was talking about the huge rise in crime in Germany. And I said, look, this is fake. I said, this is an entirely fake article. And I said, I live here, so I'm telling you, this is fake. And he didn't believe me. He did not believe me. So I think fake news is, it's an extremely dangerous thing, especially people, like I said, it's very fertile ground when people are already afraid. And they really, I mean, here I am telling this person the truth, and he's not believing me. So it's like Khomeini's face is on the moon. I think now we have Trump's face on the moon, too.
Yeah, Sandip on this.
Well, no, I agree. I mean, in the end, a lot of this, for people who wanted a reason to hate Clinton, it wasn't another affirming reason to hate Clinton. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't that somebody suddenly, I don't think that it was suddenly someone decided, you know what, that email thing is really bothering me. If it were not for the email, I would have voted for her. I mean, the fact also is Hillary Clinton has been around for so long that, in a sense, people were also tired. This was an election where people were kind of kicking out the establishment, and Hillary Clinton was quintessential establishment. You know, where the misogyny begins, you know, misogyny played a big part. Where the misogyny begins and the anti-establishment stuff ends, you know, how do we draw the line right now? I mean, I go back to when the Colin Powell emails got released with his comments about it. I was struck by the fact that Powell called, he was obviously a fan of neither, but he called Trump a national disgrace and an international pariah. But he said Clinton was this 70-year-old woman with unbridled ambition, you know, not an aspiration, nothing transformative about her, and a husband who is still, I'll use the word, dicking bimbos at home. And you look at the contrast, you think that, you know, Trump, okay, he's like a national pariah, so I won't vote for him. But for Clinton, it's her ambition, her age, her husband's affairs, which are really being held against her. So, you know, there is obviously some kind of double standard at play. But now we're in this weird situation, which is sort of unimaginable, where the Democrats are going hammer and tongs about Russia, the Republican president and China, and Republican president is saying sweet things about Putin. And now suddenly the Republicans are like attacking the CIA. So it's like become an entirely topsy-turvy situation.
Yeah, I agree with what's been said. I'm not entirely convinced that it sort of swayed the election. I do think, you know, especially since we are talking about a very small margin of votes that swung it in the end, 77,000, that it is worth giving some thought to the impact of Comey's letter that came, that was completely unnecessary. This is when the head of the FBI sent a letter out, not really saying anything beyond the fact that he was looking into something about Hillary Clinton, that in the end came to nothing, but only seemed to confirm in the minds of many people that she was somebody you had to be suspicious of and worthy of investigation by the FBI and so forth. So I think that might have had some damaging effect. But beyond that, yes, I don't think it was that significant. And I agree with Sandip that I'm very bemused now by the sort of strange Cold War-esque Russophobia that you're seeing on the part of the Democrats now. But could I say one more thing about, since you asked about external forces, I think it's also worth remembering that what we've seen by Trump is a kind of very clear reverting to an old school 19th century authoritarianism where you externalize the dysfunctions of the country. And in many ways, I mean, that's, I think, the real use of the outside world in this election. Is, you know, whether it's blaming, looking towards the Middle East or attacking the elitists in your midst as globalists or attacking Mexico and so forth, the way that the dysfunctions of the country within the country become seen as the sort of province of the outside world, and then Trump's role as this sort of father figure meant to protect everybody. You know, the most common word in his inauguration speech was protect and protection, and you know, it's a return to this very old school, late 19th century, early 20th century authoritarian nationalism.
I would like to ask, where do the Democrats go from here? Okay, Obama very popular, Clinton is over. So what are the alternative leadership coming is going to, that will determine, you know, what will happen in the next 4 years and whether Democrats can come back with a narrative which can combine their split voters who have like caught between, say, Sanders' line or the Clinton line. So where do the Democrats go from here?
Well, I can speak to that from the standpoint of communities, right, who want there to be a significant change in the political structure. You know, one of the things I think is that communities are not just relying on this two-party political system. You know, while we've had a third party in the United States for some time. It hasn't caught on in the same way that it could. And I think with Bernie Sanders and sort of the anti-establishment rhetoric that we've seen, there is an opportunity there. And many people think that that's a good thing, that between these two parties, oftentimes they look like the same. You know, the rhetoric is often the same. They're two sides of the same coin at some level. And so it'll really depend on whether or not this can actually tear down the political structures that exist and pave the way for, you know, really community governance in the United States. And that is something that a lot of activists and people in the communities are looking to. The second thing I would say really quickly is, you know, we'll have to see if the Democrats have a backbone or a spine. This is a moment to be bold and to be innovative and to actually draw some lines. And that will mean, for example, you know, resisting. I know I use that word a lot. It's become kind of my favorite word since the election. But actually resisting very clearly any efforts to normalize what Donald Trump is doing, any efforts to actually be okay with any of these administration policies. So I think that that's, at least in the immediate aftermath of this election and the administration starting to line up and the policies coming out, people around the country, activists, communities of color, are looking to see whether Democrats are going to hold the line in terms of not normalizing what's happening. Because I'm not, you know, it's going to be very unlikely for Democrats to push any sort of affirmative policies through since the GOP controls all of Congress and obviously the White House. So we're going to have to see whether they resist, how they do it, how they push back on nominations, create a lot of bureaucratic infrastructure to delay votes and that sort of thing. And then lastly, what is happening at the state and local level? A lot of the attention is going to shift to the state and local level because the federal government will literally become intractable and there won't be any way to move it or shift it. So how are progressive legislators at the local and state level responding? Can they put into place affirmative policies that protect our communities? That is another, that's another thing that a lot of activists are looking at.
Firoozeh, your comments on.
Well, I just want to say real quickly, I think that Democrats need to be seen as not just this party that spends time with George Clooney and Beyonce. I think there was a real image problem. Whereas, you know, Trump was out talking, you know, in towns where factories have closed. And Hillary Clinton was, you know, doing very elegant events. And I think that image is very important. And that definitely needs to be changed.
Sandip.
Well, I mean, the Democrats are right now in a bit of their own little civil war because obviously many of them didn't see it coming. And there is this tussle between, oh, are we going to woo back the white voter that we lost? Or are we also going to, but can we do that without calling out the racism that was also part of this campaign? So, you know, how do you do both? And some people will say, okay, shut up about the racism now. Let's figure on the economic concern of the white voter. And the other party will say, no. But in the end, you know, if the party is to have a future, it can't be an either-or situation. And I think the takeaway for both parties in this election, which was so close, is that the Republicans also have nothing to be complacent about. Because what the election showed is that while the Democrats' turnout was depressed by various factors and the people just didn't show up, 90 million people didn't show up to vote who could have voted. They didn't show up to vote. The Republicans also did not necessarily expand their base either. So, you know, both parties, and so they are stuck with a base that is aging in view of the demographic changes that are coming to the country. So both parties will have to do a real solid think about what it means going forward. Because, you know, Trump took everything backwards in some sense.
Akan.
Yeah, the Democrats are in a bit of a pickle because they have literally within the legislature almost no power whatsoever. They can barely obstruct. You know, they don't even have enough people to properly obstruct the way the Republicans did. So, you know, as Sandip mentioned, their civil war, right now the big event, I suppose, that was going to shape the coming years for their party is the election of the new head of the DNC, the Democratic National Committee. And your options are a more Bernie Sanders-esque option and a candidate that that represents the sort of more traditional, classically liberal thrust of the party. So I think we'll have to see what happens there. In practical terms, you know, it's going to be very difficult for them to make many, many gains in the congressional elections 2 years from now. But I think that will be a good measure of how successful they have been. I have been encouraged a little bit to see some of, you know, even if they're just gestures, some of the pretty strong statements and sort of resistance, I suppose, Democratic lawmakers have made to these horrific Trump cabinet appointees. But, you know, many of these Trump appointees were also a lot of these Democratic legislatures also voted for these Trump appointees to be approved. So, I mean, I think we're going to have a real measure of how well they're doing 2 years from now at elections, but I'm not optimistic, really. I think the party's in deep disarray.
Now we, like, open up to some questions. So, yeah, can somebody... We can just two questions, very short questions. Gentleman in the blue shirt, can somebody give a mic to him, please? Okay. So ask the question.
So my question is, what's next for the United States? What's the banner in 2020 or 2024? Or maybe Ivanka Trump or Mr. Jarrett? And I ask this with all seriousness because, you know, in a sense, the rest of the world emulates the United States. That's at a macro level. And on a personal level, many of us are very close relatives, I live in the United States, or we travel to the US for professional reasons. That's my question.
Any of
the panelists can answer
this. Who will take?
I'll just say one thing. Yeah. You know, one of the most terrifying things I felt I heard right after the election was people saying, Michelle Obama 2020. I'm like, you really have to get out of this thing where only an Obama or a Clinton or a Bush can go.
Very, very dynastic. Yeah. Pradeep.
Can I just suggest that there is a risk of overanalysis here? You know, it's possible that after 8 years of Obama, even if you would put a broomstick next to Hillary, because people wanted a change. And motivation researchers looking at why people smoke, and they kept coming up with answers that, oh, because they need a sense of masculinity, therefore they smoke, or because they were frustrated during the oral stage of development, not enough breastfeeding, therefore they smoke. And someone came up with the answer, hell, maybe they smoke because they like the taste. So let's not perhaps overanalyze why Trump won. It could simply be that 8 years of Democratic Obama rule, anyone else would have won.
Yeah, we have made the point, this anti-establishment sentiment, which was very strong, and the Obama legacy obviously could not inspire the people to vote for Clinton. We did that.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. At some level, I think we need to move beyond the analysis part. And I think what we need to move into is the reality. And the reality right now in the United States, you know, 4 days in to this president assuming the power at the White House, is that already we have seen him ensure that poor women around the country are not going to have access to health care and reproductive care. We're about to see in 6 hours, actually, a set of executive orders that will ban people from entering the United States if they come from 8 countries in the world that are seen as terror-prone countries. We're going to see a shutdown of our refugee system where we accept people who are fleeing persecution for 120 days for review, and then a ban on Syrian refugees. We're going to see something called a values test. To enter the U.S., you have to show that you have, quote, American values. This is a reality that people are living under right now. And so regardless of, you know, why he won or who voted, I agree that we need to move beyond that and actually deal with the real situation, the consequences of what it means to have someone who is a fascist, white supremacist, racist, misogynist in office in this country, right? Because it is a sea change, and it is going to have implications not just on Americans, but people wanting to come to America and on other countries in the world.
And I would just add to that, you know, I think because Trump is who he is actually worth thinking about why he won. You know, this is not just any other leader. It's quite an important change in the history of recent political leadership in the world. And it because of what's happening in Europe and other parts of the world in terms of the kinds of governments coming into being, I think it's worth seeing what lies behind this trend, this growing authoritarianism, which we can't deny is in many places in the world. So I think it's worth thinking about.
How many Indians vote in the US in percentage terms and real terms, and did Apkibar Trump Sarkar have any sway on that?
Remember, so there's the slogan from Narendra Modi here was Ab Ki Baar Modi Sarkar. And so the rally, that the South Asian rally for Trump, they raised the slogan. And then Trump issued a video where he said Ab Ki Baar Trump Sarkar.
Yeah. Very quickly, because we have to close. Indian Americans are the fastest growing race group in the United States. So it's a large number of people living there. In terms of the amount of people who are eligible to vote, I don't have the numbers on top of my head. But for the most part, we know from exit polling that Indians usually vote Democrat. And they did again this year. They voted for Hillary Clinton overwhelmingly. There is a very small, very small minority of people who are like Republicans for Trump, right? Like that rally we saw in New Jersey. We're also seeing some South Asians being actually appointed to positions of power. Nikki Haley just got appointed to be UN ambassador. Right. She got confirmed yesterday. Ajit Pai is the new FCC chair. So we're seeing Indians in the Trump administration, which is another question of how we're being used, how our communities are being used to kind of being tokenized as, how are our communities going to be framed as criminals and also as people who belong to this administration. So that's going to be an interesting dynamic as well.
Okay, thank you all. We have to shut it now. Thank you for watching.
Thank you.